Okay, let's get started. We have content to share, so we'll be making good use of time. So I'm going to start by a couple of introductions. I was not supposed to present today, but our team is operating as a kind of cluster. So I'm the N plus one of Rick Fang. So it kind of overflowed to me. I'm going to present his slides. If you were in this morning session, it's probably the second time you will see those slides, but there is a video with it, so you will get a bit more information about Workspace. This session is about Pure-Engage Cloud, both on-prem and cloud. Just make sure you're in the right room. And so I mentioned Rick Fang, our product senior director, product manager. He's currently busy on another presentation. I'm Maurice Nicolas. I've been dealing with agents and supervisor facing UI since 2000, when I joined the business. Stéphane Bacon will do the core of the presentation, all the technical information about Workspace 9 and specific integration capabilities. And we also have in the room Bruno Pogam, who is leading development for desktop edition and software indicator applications on this topic as well. And I will start by apologizing already because all the three of us are French, so you may have a lot of French accent during the presentation. So, sorry for that. So the agenda. Quick introduction to Workspace 9. We'll start with that. We have a bunch of new capabilities and the new UI. And then we have a presentation of the architecture, all the capabilities around web application integration that exists already in 8.5, but we extended it now. In 9, so we have all the 9 evolutions integrating by provisioning. All the evolutions around service client API, JavaScript API, that allows you to interact with the product with your custom implementation embedded into an iframe. And we'll say a word if we have time about Toolkit, which is a brand new product that is not released, but will be released soon, hopefully. So there is a lot of content in architecture presentation, web application integration, SCAPI, and so on. So we'll make a stop after each item so you can raise any question that you have and you have a more interactive dialogue, let's say 5-10 minutes. And then we'll dive into the next item. So that's it for the agenda. So Workspace 9. You probably heard this morning if you were in the session about OpenAPI. That GWS went between 8.5 and 9 to a major refactoring. So we moved from an architecture, pretty much monolithic architecture, towards a microservice architecture. And Workspace 9 is built on top of this new architecture and leverage all the capabilities that GWS 9 is offering. So we have this microservice approach with a kind of separation of concern pattern where each single microservice is having a very well-defined role, and we are not mixing stuff within each microservice. So Stefan will share the architecture, you will have more details on that. On Workspace 9 specifically, we focus on extensibility, improving efficiency of our users, our agents, our supervisors, and we also worked on bringing a more modern look and feel. So I have a demo video coming from Rick, you can go through. Thank you.
Okay, so I was saying that we build the application on top of GWS new architecture, and we build it in a way that it's becoming an integration platform. So we are exposing integration points. Those integration points are used internally today by other teams outside of my own team to build content and to deliver more features more rapidly. And those integration points are also available externally to integrate with CRM system, to integrate with business application. So the goal is to accelerate integration internally and externally. Version 9 is supporting the set of features that 8.5 was supporting, so we have a priority level from that perspective. There are some changes at the UI level, but we made them limited so that we improve user efficiency, but at the same time we limit the cost of training for agents. So it shouldn't be a big deal to move from 8.5 to 9. You shouldn't have to train your agents specifically. And what I wanted to mention on this slide is there are a couple of features that are not yet available in prem. So typically, social support is available in cloud. So we build the application as an integration platform. So the sidebar, the appearance of the sidebar and the navbar is really helping in injecting some content in the application. So if you look at the first image on the top, you see that in the sidebar we have three icons that are actually pointing to third-party applications. You can add in the navbar your own entry, and you will see that live later in this session. And you can also use the full screen if you need to, so you have a background mode where you can use the whole screen on the stage for your own content. And as you had in H5, you also can add custom tabs within live interactions.
So with your integration into CRMs, you can sugar CRM is your favorite demo one, but that's putting it in your tool. Can you fit within CRM?
So that's the next slide. Thank you. So all those integrations, we are showing self-party content within Workspace, and we really worked hard in making the user experience very nice and have a nice flow between the self-party content and Workspace. There are some cases where this is not possible, and there are some other options. I was going to mention toolkits. This is a situation where you want to embed pieces of Workspace in another application. So this is very, very, very fresh. You will see later in the session more details about what this toolkit is about, and I hope we'll be able to release it soon. The intent of the toolkit is really to embed Workspace in existing app, not really to build an app from. I think that's going to be it for me. I will let Stefan now deal with technical stuff. Tomorrow we have a hands-on where you will actually be able to play with the toolkits, so you can come with your laptops and you will be given all the necessary material to actually build your own application. So it should be interesting stuff. Okay.
Okay, let's talk about architecture in 9 compared to 8.5. There are a lot of changes in UI. We improved the UI, but the big changing is in the server side. If you look on this slide, then you see the new architecture. GWS 9 is based on microservices. A set of microservices. In 8.5, in fact, the GWS was a single artifact that can be instantiated for different roles, statistics, API, and so on, configuration, and so on. And you can create different nodes with different roles, but it was the same code between those instances. Inman is completely different. We divided the solution in different microservices. You can start at the top. Then the browser, when you are using Workspace ONE, is connected to some microservices that are in front. Then first, we have a WWE UI. What it is, it's a microservice based on Nginx, containing all static files to expose them to the browser. And also, this one is connected on the cloud to Consul, to mention where the API is for the service discovery. After this, we have the browser is consuming a WWE API, and this is an aggregator of sub-microservices developed in TypeScript, and running with Node.js, and it's a server based on JavaScript, on server side. We have also GWS port for authentication, because GWS 9 is based on the Flow port 2. Then the authentication part is dedicated to this microservice, and also Auth UI for login pages. And the login is done in two steps. And those pages are in Auth UI and not WWE UI. Auth UI also has the same architecture than Workspace ONE UI, in based on Nginx to expose the static resources. All microservices are embedded in a container with a Docker. In terms of interesting connections, WWE is connected, of course, to GWS port to manage the authentication, to be sure that the token of authentication is available for the session. WWE is also connected to Redis, allowing to store a session among nodes. It means that if a node of Workspace ONE is down, automatically the browser could jump with the load balancer to another node and the session is reinstantiated. The agent should not have to relog again. It's different compared to A.5. Also, testing microservice is GWS setting API. This one, for Workspace ONE, we are using it to store personal favorites, recents, and so on for long persistent storage. And it is stored in PostgreSQL. SQL, sorry.
So, do you store recent when you make communication?
When you are in a team communicator, when you are engaging in conversation with someone, then this conversation is stored in recent until for the next usage of team communicator. It's like a shortcut to previous
program.
It's different also. You will still use UCS, but this is for the purpose of UCS. Oh no, of the team communicator.
Okay, that replaces Elasticsearch in this?
No, the Elasticsearch is not in this one, and it's a recent microservice named. What is the name? There is a new microservice to.
Targets.
Sorry?
Targets?
Oh, it's yes, for targets. It's this one is using Elasticsearch for searching in Team Communicator. We have also GWS of API and WAPI is connected to this one to know which environment and which GDS suite to connect to, because in the cloud GWS is shared. It means that in PEC, each customer has its own Genesis suite, and to know for the donor to which Genesis suite to use, then GWS ONF is used. And after, then to connect to legacy servers from Genesis, like TAT server, SIP server, Config server, then the WAPI is not connected directly. It's connected to GWS Stat API for the reporting aspect, GWS Voice for everything related to telephony, and GWS Configuration for the configuration from Config Server. and means that in Visual Solution, all microservices are discussing via via REST API and Comedy at this time. Potentially, we move to another technology based on Redis and PubSub to discuss among microservices. For the connection between the browser and WAPI, and it's also REST API, the aggregator WAPI is providing REST API, plus Comedy, like in 8.5, about the real-time aspect.
Comedy is still there?
Yes, Comedy is still there. Okay, with long polling mechanism at this time.
Okay.
But no web sockets.
No web sockets at this time.
There is a single Postgre SQL database?
GWS ARC is connected to PostgreSQL to SQL to have information about the Genesis suite.
The code
like the Genesis configuration that is
it's a in fact it's not another but it could be means mostly it's a new database but mostly it could be the same cluster of Postgres in another instance.
Yeah, but what kind of data is it? Because previously you didn't find web
the IP address of the config server and so on.
Okay, so this is a kind of a copy of a configuration database.
No, it's because GWS 9 is shared. It means that for when an agent is notified for a particular tenant, in this case, GWS ARM has enough information to know on which config server to get information.
Okay. So it's kind of a subset.
Yeah.
Is that what Cassandra 8.5 is using Cassandra for to replicate the config?
Then the Cassandra disappeared in 9,
But in 8, it implicates the config database.
Yeah.
Kind of the same
one. Yeah. Now, in fact, the configuration is coming directly from GWS Conf, connected directly to config server.
Yeah, it's not identical to 8.5. There is configuration information in Postgre. But in 8.5, you have a lot of replication. So the amount of information
will there be new configuration UIs for this? For the besides GA
configuration?
Like for corporate favorites for instance, right? For WWE.
No. Most of options from 8.5 are similar in 9.
Okay.
In terms of UI.
Yeah.
And we have still in 9 the cluster application with connection to SIP server, to UCS, and so on. And mostly this is similar.
Maybe as an example, we are migrating currently new customers in our cloud from 8.5 to 9.
Mm-hmm.
And this migration process is very small change in the what we call the tenant configuration. So what is really the configuration server? We're just adjusting couple of options that which have been renamed, but the structure itself in the tenant structure in config server is pretty much the same.
Okay.
Also, that some microservices are developed in Java, like auth, setting, and so on top of using Spring. In terms of microservices, we have different kind of technology used inside. That's the new architecture based on microservices.
In terms of migration, can you have 8.5 and 9.0 both working at the same time?
Okay. Yeah, that's how we migrate our EDC customers. We continue to operate on 8.5 while we enable the operation on 9. We start with some UAT on 9, right? And at some point, there was a cutover that
right.
Several steps and sharing most, as I mentioned, sharing mostly the configuration.
I think that's about microservices. I just put this this architecture slide about the modular aspect of Workspace Web. And in fact, Workspace Web is in ideas from Workspace Desktop. We implemented with the notion of module, the segmentation per notion. And for example, we have, of course, in front we have the WW main. This one has the most logic to load different kind of module, and WW logging also. There is a specific module for the logging because to avoid the payload to display the login page, we have a dedicated module for the login that allows to reduce the size of exchange during this step. But this way, the login page appears more quickly. And after this, we have a different kind of module. We have one for voice. Some are inheriting, like outbound, voicemail, the connection to the SIP endpoint. I will explain more about this one on another slide. And then there is an hierarchy that, for example, if, and most of those modules are related to options to activate or disable them. And if you disable the voice, automatically the outbound and so on will not be loaded. Mostly, this is a current list of modules that are part of Workspace, and then most are related to core development, but you can see that we have some modules like AltoCloud. AltoCloud team is working with us and developing this module to have this integration. We have the co-growth team also, to introducing some feature in our product. And obtain, by this way, you obtain this feature natively without any plugin to deploy. In terms of development for Workspace Web, and Workspace Web is an HTML5 application, like in .5. We are still using Backbone.js as framework. We didn't migrate to Angular, React, or Vue.js. Because for now we are using a lot of line of code, because we have more than 100,000 line of code, and migrating all in other language will be really costly, and we need a study to see if there is a real benefit, and in reality, then we just upgrade the version of Backbone that we are using. For the Comedy aspect, then we are using the 3.1 version. For the UI aspect, we are using jQuery. About any views using a table with sorting and so on, we are using a third-party named data table. And for the disposition and the standard responses, we need a tree, and we are using a library named JS3. What is new is we are using a Vue.js to make a library of widgets, but based on web component technology. But we are really looking to migrate to Stencil because it's really better than temporary usage of Vue. Text loader is for localization. We migrate from require to webpack, then we introduce also the notion of Babel for polyfill to, because we are able to develop in ES6 JavaScript, but as we are supporting IE11, this version of JavaScript is not supported by this browser, and we are using Babel to translate to ES5 JavaScript to avoid any issue on the usage of the application. Mostly it's the main third party that we are using in client side. This one is an interesting slide that describing a particular architecture that we have with some endpoints application, and we have a Genesis soft one, for example, presented here. This architecture is also applicable for the screen recording. We have something really similar. Then how it works? In fact, the feature that the software provider cannot be developed directly in JavaScript. It should be in a native application, and the same for the screen recording. Then we have an endpoint running on the same machine that the agent. And we put a mechanism allowing to the browser to discuss with this application. Then the endpoint, the JSON file, how it address this. In fact, it integrates a mini web server in it. And the browser is discussing to localhost, to a particular port, to send some command and get some information from this endpoint. And if we are looking about the flow for the...
Is that a SoftPhone still a native Windows app, or is it in the browser?
No, it's a native app.
Running it's still a native app. Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, we are looking to integrate, to support WebRTC natively from the browser.
Yeah.
But for this architecture, it's with a native app thank like this SoftPhone. Or excuse me, code.
Is it Windows only still? Or?
Yeah, SoftPhone is still Windows only. What changed on the SoftPhone side is that now we have official support of the VDI for Citrix.
Okay.
We also started with Windows, but soon introduce. So the principle is that we have a plugin installed on the Synclavium, on the Synclavium piece. Like for Scala for Business, for example, and still the software as an application is still the VDI, but the device layer, the media layer, is located locally on the workstation for all the same clients. So we started with Windows and Citrix on Windows, and soon we will have Citrix on Linux, which is a thin client architecture based on Linux. And planning to move also to VMware in the future.
Okay.
So the goal is to keep the software on Windows for now, on the VDI side, and introduce more connectors on the, as plugins on the client side.
How does it connect to the license server? How is it licensed?
There is no technical license for the software. Pretty much the license is more on the SIP side. You register on the SIP server, that's where I get the license. But this,
So I just wanted to emphasize the fact that this architecture is absolutely great to limit the effort in deployment phase, because you can centralize all your configuration. You don't have to deploy configuration across of one car machine. So this is really helpful. And to answer the question about WebRTC within the browser, this is being worked on.
So how's the software getting the configuration?
Through Workspace.
Yeah, through Workspace. And I think somebody said that there's a web server running somewhere. Is that running on the software?
The software integrates just the...
The software integrates just the small HTTP listener. It's not a web server per se, but it's able to intercept HTTP requests,
okay,
or HTTPS requests,
okay,
which is accepting connections only from the localhost.
Okay.
So it's on one connection at a time, which is very limited.
Okay.
Web server.
So the WWE, the browser page, JavaScript calls in the local host, whatever port that software is running, to configure it.
Yeah.
Configure it, and then it asks it to register to the SDC. And then once that is done, the workspace can actually log in the agent for the previous available port of view. And code can be loaded.
It is described in the flow. In fact, in the step zero, then we have to configure in auto start the software or the screen recording. And the process is present before the session of the agent. Of Workspace, and the agent is using the interface of Workspace. And first step is authentication to GWS port, authentication is obtained, then we are able to look above the configuration and see that there is a software connection set for the user. Then the workspace is contacting the localhost on the particular port set in the configuration to obtain to provide information to the step two to the software, the DN and so on, and the password of the DN is present, allowing to the software to connect to the SDC and C server to initiate. And after this, then we start really the session of workspace. By contacting GWS. But we are waiting during the login step that the register is fine with the software before to jump to the next. And like I said, this is the software presented, but you can you have also the same. Some exchanges with the screen record, same architecture. And HTTPS is required if Workspace is running HTTPS, this is the case of cloud. And the browser requires that all connections will be also in HTTPS. And it's safer to do HTTPS. This is the reason why the software also supports this protocol. That's it for the district connector. Other point is, we introduced recently in Workspace 9 the support of disaster recovery. And it's something that we implemented for the cloud in 8.5. And for the moment, it's only for the cloud. We are looking to have it in premise, but it's not the case right now. Then how it works. In fact, the idea is Workspace is connected to a region, and if there is a problem on this region, to jump to another region and try to keep at maximum the location of the region information and, to minimize the impact to the user. Then to specify that we are in disaster, then there is an option to set on Workspace, and also the URL of Workspace is really particular. The first part of the URL is the entry point to connect to Workspace URL, and after you have an argument seat 1. This one is the other region that should be contacted in case of problem. Which case we are triggering a disaster, then if we have a problem on logging, then we try to the other region. If we have a disconnection, a long period of COVID-D, for example, 40 seconds without any reconnection back, then we can consider that the region, we have an issue with the region that we need to jump to the other region. And about the disconnection, it means that if the voice service and the server is done during another 1 minute or 2 minutes, we can consider that we need to jump to another region and to address the
problem. And, so I'm sorry to interrupt. So we're talking basically automatic failover now, instead of having to, for now we have to log in. The AHS has to log in to one side or the other, right?
Yeah.
So we're moving towards the auto failover.
Basically,
they can determine how my east down must go to backup, basically, if they log in. Am I understanding that right?
The intent here is to avoid situation where the agent will have to hit another URL, another link,
right,
and log in again at another location. So they not have to think about that. It's going to happen automatically. What is going to stay in this user experience is the credential part. Because the IDPs are not always synced to the region. So the agent will have to enter credential again. But this will pop up automatically. You will not ask the agent to go to a particular URL. Yeah.
So I will say the 3 o'clock in the morning call phone goes up when they can't get in one side.
For security purpose, we are not storing the password and the username in the browser. And this is, and we don't have this information. It's managed by. In fact, the notification now in 9 is managed by another service. you will see during the demonstration that the URL during the login flow is changing between Workspace and OQI and back to Workspace. And it's like a black box, and you don't have access to this image. And if in the future we are able to have a cross region, the management of user session, we should be able to be more transparent in transition between two regions. But at this time, it's true that we have to re-enter the credential. That's about our architecture for the story problem. I put this slide just to describe a little how we are developing, and GenuREST 9 is something like 15 or 20 microservices. Each microservice are considered as a component. Each microservice has its all microservices have related to code stored in the same repository, and all the code in the same repository. And but each microservice has its own pipeline to try to generate an artifact when a developer pushes the code. Each time that a developer is pushing the code, the relative pipeline to this component is executed to run a build, unit test, functional test, and so on. And if everything is okay, then we, for this component, we try to flag it as a stable. Then the artifact generated is transmitted to an integration pipeline, and this is the third step, integration pipeline. And this one, we run again a test with this candidate with other stable microservices, and see everything is fine. If everything is fine, then this one is flagged as stable. And after this, when every 8 hours we are updating our staging environment to do driving the pattern to the closer to the positioning cloud to do some automation test also. And if everything is okay, then we can generate artifact for production. And this is the kind of pipeline that we have now in 9. In entry, we have a lot of pipeline in front related to each microservice. But the structure of those pipelines are common. Some structure, compilation, unit test, functional test, and generation of the artifact, pushing the artifact to the common register.
Stefan.
Yeah, just as an indication, we are releasing to on-prem roughly every quarter, but we are releasing to cloud every 2 weeks. And obviously, we are aiming at releasing more frequently. Our testing pipeline is fitting this objective, but for now, it's kind of the pace is kind of every 2 weeks.
In terms of security, and first the O2 flow, I'm going to do some integration with SAML and so on. And this is abstract by GWS O2 microservice. Well, what else about security? Then we will see later in this session the presentation of the service client API, the API allowing to have exchanges between a website or web application integrating Workspace with Workspace. And then we have a set of options to let the possibility to reduce action from a website to allow someone to capture attached data from all interactions, some stuff like this. Protect at maximum the product. In terms of development, we have the script to avoid XSS issues, to identify at maximum during the build, to avoid the bad surface during the from production. We are using also Checkmart, third-party application that we are using, running daily base, and we have a report on it related to the lattice code for the website. We have Sonar run on each push, and it's part of our first step of the pipeline for production. This one is looking about the quality of the code, and also about code coverage. We have to have more than 80% of unit tests of the application to go to the next step during the build. We are using Black Duck. Black Duck is really important. It's about license mostly, and security also, to be sure that we don't have any issue of GPL license embedded in the product. And also, this tool has a knowledge base of security issues from different third parties that we are using, and put an alert if we are using an old version, or if in the current version there is a big problem, and the solution consists in upgrading or to migrate to another third party. And the latest issue is, latest item is ZDAF proxy, and this one is simulating attack and try to identify different kinds of security issues. Mostly in the, this one is about the server side aspect. ZDAF proxy is capturing exchanging from the browser and try to imagine how to corrupt the server with variation of request. About Black Duck and Sonar, this one is executed for UIs, like Workspace, like Auth, but also for microservices, like Voice, WFI, and so on. So this is different kind of element that we are thinking about security. Supported browser, the Workspace is a question. Then we are supporting Chrome. At this time, it's 54 and plus. This one is start to be old. And we have to review this as Edge. Then the old Edge, not the Chromium Edge, because Microsoft is looking to use Chromium from Google to as a base for the navigator. And this seems really promising because we did some tests with the canaries and it seems working fine. It's not announced as supported, but it's still not official for Microsoft also.
Any plan for Safari?
Not at this time. Let's see from the roadmap from Mac. We have Firefox also, 45. And we have still Internet Explorer 11. We have several customers requesting it. And this one is really problematic because it has a lot of limitations in terms of HTML5 features. It doesn't support very well WebWorker. Service content API based on post message is not working well with pop-up. We have a limitation in IE11. With it. In terms of machine, then at this time we are Lightning 8.5, we are requesting a dual core on 2.8 GHz with a minimum 2 GB, but we recommend 4 GB of memory. Workspace is consuming, needs some resources to work fine because the UI is really rich. And,
Have you tested on Chromebooks?
No.
Okay.
I would like to do a short demo of Workspace. And you will see the similar thing that you saw during the video presented by Boris. And just one thing is, how will we proceed for this demo then? I will use a platform that we use for the hands-on tomorrow. And I am not connected to cloud environment or local. I'm using a GWS simulator that we have developed in Node.js, simulating a part of the API and part of Comedy event, allowing to manage user session, fake inbound call, fake inbound chat, and so on. And this one is will be used tomorrow, and the idea is to share with you this one, and by this way you could work locally and safely with it. And for the toolkit, we are always seeking to deliver it in the package, allowing to allow you to develop offline way without be constrained. Allowing also potentially to make some advanced use cases by tricking its content. The idea is to deliver it as an open source, allowing you to adjust with them. Then I run just another command, allowing to start the simulator. And now the simulator, in fact, is running on my machine on. Localhost 7777. And there is an interface to manage the simulator. And the simulator, the main entry is this one, allowing me to say for this part of the demo, we use just the worst test, and I will select worst test. Automatically, it opens the login page to worst test. Then in the simulator, what we have, and we have a part of the logical to expose the fake events, fake information from GWS, and also we have an instance of Workspace Web. Then we have a set of users, and I will use for this John Smith. And look also in the UI. The URL, sorry, is /auth, then we are on auth UI, and you will see we jump after to Workspace UI. And I'm entering the username, the password. And you can see that in the URL, now it's not auth, but it's WWE. We switch to auth Microsoft, and we switch between auth UI and Workspace. And from the interface, and like in the video, what is really new is the navigation bar, and the burger disappeared. Has been replaced by this navigation bar with two levels. First level, we have at this time connect and monitor. Monitor presenting the contact center statistics or my agent, if it's configured for the user. And the other one is connect is my channel. It's my channel, my campaign, and so on. In the left, we have the sidebar, and Team Communicator is part of the sidebar now. It's integrated in it. From Team Communicator, you can search someone, and I'm search Kate, but Kate is not logged in. I can connect Kate to the simulator also. Okay. I have two instances of browser. And if I search Kate, now I see Kate ready. What is new also with the Team Communicator is it's embedded in sidebar, and now by default you don't have operation allowing to do the make call and so on. It's only an overlay, and you have operation appearing like make call. I will call Kate or add not add to favorite. So. Yeah, you can add in favorite. We have also notification, and this is in case of error, but it will be used in the future for broadcast messages, this part to tell
information about broadcasted message. Then this is the third entry is voicemail. To see a voicemail, and the submitter allowed to submit fake voicemail. And you can see that it's presented by this way, and if the agent clicks on it, automatically the voicemail is called. And the latest is we have this great widget allowing to display the current to my statistics. You can put some threshold and you see where we are. You can have you see also there is a badge on the icon mentioning that there are four items that are in the badge shell to put you in the focus. The badge is also on the voicemail to alert you that you have something to look.
Yeah, just a word about performance tracker. So if you're familiar with the cloud version of Workspace 8.5, today in the product we have, for some customers, we have something called dashboard, where you see on the main screen a couple of statistics for the agent and some statistics for the waiting points. This UI is going away and it's replaced by performance tracker. So it's going to disappear anyway. But all those statistics, they are still available either in performance tracker or in the contact center statistics tab. So you still can provide the same level of information, simply it's located in the tutorials.
And we're
going
to have time in here still. Sure, yeah.
Do you have plans to consolidate even more, like if there are three VQs, you know, consolidated of all three at once? Or?
So, I cannot speak for Rick, but the intention, we have a monitor entry in the network. Under this monitor entry, the intention is to build a kind of widget dashboard, widget-based dashboard,
okay,
where you can add pretty much the stuff you want to put here.
Okay. All right. Would you replace Pulse or just augment Pulse?
That's a good question. So the intention is, the initial intention is to leverage Pulse, but we didn't work yet on the topic to provide a sound answer.
Can you use Pulse in other areas too then?
So the next topic is Service Client API, and you could put a lot of stuff within Workspace. And, we've seen a lot of stuff actually, sometimes very surprising to us, but yeah, whatever web
application. We're using for wall boards and stuff like that too, so
yeah.
Also, so.
Yeah.
But there's, yeah, I can create a Nimbom chat. And for the simulator, then there is a Nimbom chat. What's interesting is you can see that from the sidebar, and the color of the selection is red. Okay? And now, you see that the color is gray because, in fact, what does it mean? It means that in background, monitor is selected, but currently doesn't have the focus. The focus is on the interaction because the interaction is uniform. And if I collapse it, what does it mean? It means that what I see in background is not something related to the interaction, it's related really to monitor. And I see dashboard and manager. The color of the sidebar has a signification about what it is presented in the background. So if it is gray, it means that it's related to the interaction. And we will see that it's possible to have a website in background. It could be confusing, but it's a feature that we are offering. And when it's red, it means that what is in background is really related to what it is from the navbar or from monitor, for example. Connect. For the chat compare to 8.5, and then we need an improvement to mimic Workspace desktop with a bubble rendering instead of old school rendering. The progress that we need for this media. mostly it's all about general plantation for space.
So on-premise, do you support async chat and workbench views of async chat in WWE?
No. Not for the moment.
No, async chat is among the features that are supported on the cloud for the moment.
Okay. So it's social and async chat both?
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
Yes, it will be shared.
It
will be shared during the answer, and we will deliver it as a package with the toolkit. So it's really a tool, and the objective of the simulator is really to speed up the initial steps of development, see how the UI is behaving, these kind of things. So it's definitely not something to use in production.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's to use a sample. You can jump to the. Any question about architecture before to jump to web integration?
I have one question.
Yeah.
I saw you browsing in the contents. Most contents could be integrated with directory or Office 365.
You mean when
inside the integrator
when I'm trying to find someone?
Yes.
For the moment, no. It's entries are coming from a config server for agent, routing point, interaction queue, or UCS. But at this time, we didn't open the.
Yeah, the team communicator, there is no integration with what different source for the targets that we are presenting. But it really depends what kind of use case you have in mind. If you have a UI that presents those users, you can still have that as part of workspace and use, for instance, the click-to-dial function that we are exposing through Snap and click-to-dial from your own UI presenting your Office 365 users. So it's not integrated in TIPCOM, but you still have the capability to click-to-dial from your own list of users.
Click-to-dial function, is this valid for all the browsers and all pages which we are opening, or just for that?
So click-to-dial is a function that is exposed by SCAPI, and you can use it within your own custom implementation. So it depends what kind of access you have to your business app, but pretty much use it in the way you want.
Thank you.
Okay.
Any about web application integration? Before to go to SCAPI, this section is describing how to configure integration or integrations, because it's possible to integrate several websites in Workspace. And first, this is Workspace provides three areas to integrate website interaction. It means that the website is associated to the interaction, appearing with it and disappearing with it. And from the browser, the related iframe or pop-up is the automatic close when the agent is pressing markdown. We have a navigation bar, and you can custom the navigation bar with web pages. And the sidebar, where our team communicator is. For this, then there are a set of options, interaction.webcontent, then this one allows to specify website associated to interaction. And this option supports the overriding by strategy. It means by the strategy you can define which website should be associated to an interaction depending on the context, and could also avoid to associate one based on this mechanism inherited also from best application. View.NavigationBar, then this one allows to specify the order in this component to integrate the website. The sidebar, and we have a particular mode, it's hidden. This one is used mostly for synchronization with CRM, and it's possible to have a web page embedded in Workspace, not presented to the user, and the idea is just to have some logical in JavaScript to capture information from Workspace,
to send that to a CRM or a deposit from the web application to generate some stuff on Workspace, like stop the recording, and so on via Skype. For our website, then we specify a label, a URL, and a mode of display. Internal means integrated in Workspace, based on iframe. Background is also based on iframe, but in background of the interaction, or we will see also in the navbar what will be the behavior. External is a pop-up. Then open when the interaction appears or when the desktop is presented. And close at the end of the interaction or at the end of the session of the agent. And we have hidden, like I mentioned, the technical mode.
We have a custom page that we pop up in the interaction window today for transfer, because we do transfers differently than WWE does, and it's not customizable, so we built our own. So you're saying we can put that in the sidebar and leave it up all the time, so it's not required to be part of the interaction? Is that a use case like, that might work?
For the sidebar?
Yeah.
Sidebar is normally, so the sidebar is small, you cannot resize it. And the size is what you saw with the performance tracker, you can extend it. And the idea is to have, if you have enough space and to go quick, it's a good place to.
The reason why we built our own is because we can change the look and feel in ways that you can't do. So resizing isn't necessarily the problem, but sometimes our agents want to use that same functionality for an outbound call.
Yeah.
But it's not available because there's no interaction. So if we put it on the sidebar, it would be there all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be a good case. Is that what this supports now? We can have a.
Yeah. Yeah, I will demonstrate this at the end of the presentation. For integration done in the product is iframe and pop-up window. Other cool feature is like in .5, we support field code to render the URL. This one is mostly useful with attached data, and you can capture an ID from attached data and populate it in the URL to show the particular profile of the contact or something else. And you have full name, username, last name, first name, employee ID, and attached data. We have for this one is allowing to put more complexity when you have attached data. It means that by default, if the attached data change during the interaction session, then the website is not repopulated. And if the UI is based on the field code based on attached data, and if data change, we won't change the render. With the mode 1, it's possible, but if the attached data disappears, the website is still present. And the mode 2 is if the attached data is updated, then automatically the website is updated, and if the attached data disappears, the website disappears. So you can adjust as you want per website with this mode. For website, then is not in interaction workspace section. This website is described in a dedicated section where you have the label, the URL, and the mode. And we introduce new options in terms of security to allow or not the usage of the microphone, camera. It would be interesting some in advance use cases. And the sandbox, it's mostly to secure the product. And by default, we allow JavaScript forms, allow to do a pop-up and navigate on different origins. But you can adjust if you want to secure more the integration. There is new options added in the workspace to review the default option for the sandbox, the second attribute of the list. In terms of provisioning, the navigation bar has a set of options to manage the order of display, the order of activation. Then the activation is a list of views. And if the view is, and we start with the first, and if this one is available when we present it at first, then it's automatically selected.
If this view is not present due to some privileges, some options that mention that this feature is not for this agent, then we will check with the second and so on until to find the one to present. So really, cool feature, activate order. And it's possible to create a custom region, and custom is at the same level that connect our monitor. This is an example, set of example of web integration, and in Connect, I added a tab for Service Center API, for example. I added at first level a new customs section named Tools, containing two web applications, one Bing integration, and the other one is Airlines, fake online website, and the latest is a CRM, and this CRM is really particular. This one is a website in background taking the full space, and there is no second level, it's taking the full space in the navigation bar. And at the left you can see a different kind of option that have been set to address those different kind of and we play with the notion of order, activation order, and for example here then we have the tools is a custom region 1, and I put it just after connect region, and if we have a statistics set, then monitoring region should appear after. And after we have custom region 2, it's for CRM. And you can see that from my provisioning in the screenshot, I don't have any statistics, then monitoring is not appearing. Then automatically, CRM appear just after tools. WordPress readjust depending on privilege. Really flexible. And this is a list of different websites integrated with different modes in background for CRM. I don't have any features for this one. During the hands-on tomorrow also, there is a course about web integration, and we will play with field code to understand how it works. And field code is just the name of the field code between a dollar character. And by this way, the URL is rendered with this field code before to be transmitted to the pop-up or the DIY. If you want a pop-up at workspace level, then it should be in the workspace.web content option. And this one option was in 8.5 when we don't have this notion of navigation bar with different levels, different entries. But we keep it just for external. For internal, they have to be set in navigation bar options. For the sidebar, then this one is an example of integration with the sidebar. Then I will demonstrate this one just after. Then I customize the sidebar with the top ready icon. This one is associated to a website in hidden mode, it's not displayed, and when you click on it, it calls SCAPI to force to ready the agent. It's like a shortcut, in fact. And this one is really particular because in hidden mode, when each time that you click, the website is reloaded to re-execute the step.
Can you externalize that, make it pop up?
Yes.
A lot of websites won't allow you to embed in design for apps like Salesforce.
Then this is the case of Google, for example. Google is this one, and I put external, and it's just a shortcut to obtain the pop-up. And SearchLand is integrated. So it appears in the sidebar. What else? And this is integration at interaction level. This one is in internal mode. Internal mode, it is presented in the right side of the interaction. And I used two field codes, attachData.firstName and attach data, that last name, in the array to generate this, the query to Bing presented in this panel. Other mode is, this one is the mode background. Then when the attraction is collapsed, in fact, the website is presented in background. And if you like to see what it is in background of the background, it means at the navigation bar level, you have to click on the navigation bar. And this is the main purpose of the gray color, to mention that the website that is presented here is associated to the interaction. If it was red, it means it was associated to the navigation bar. About external mode, and this is a good mention about constraints with some websites like Google and so on. Then some, most of websites don't authorize iframe integration. Mostly at this time with its iframe option, it's a header in HTTP, but there is a new technology named CSP allowing to be more flexible and disappear. Some sites are supporting it, but not a lot. Mostly, most of websites are protected with this. And why they are doing this, it's about clickjacking. What they are afraid is you put an iframe in a website, and in front, and you display the website in it, and in front, you put a div in overlay simulating, for example, the logging component. And you enter your username and password on this fake authentication panel, and by this way they can capture. This is the main purpose of this protection, the reason why Google and so on doesn't authorize this. Or mostly also it's to avoid to embed their business in your application, like you offer the stuff that finally they embed. This is a about pop-up, then potentially your browser doesn't authorize for the website the pop-up, and this case and workspace put an alert, and you can then by the way the agent is alerted, and mostly the agent should go to the URL bar and accept the pop-up or click directly the toast from the alert to see the website after. Question about web integration?
Yes, here we see an auto integrated application inside the vulnerability.
Yeah.
But at the beginning, I saw that I understood that now we can do there's a way around and integrate WWW inside the third party application. Is that right?
For this part, it's based on the toolkit for such kind of integration. We have some customer that embed workspace in iframe completely. Mm-hmm. It's possible.
But if I want to embed it in a remote channel, like remote channel or something like that, like I present it as a widget or a portrait.
Yeah, so in most of those cases, the answer will be the toolkit. Because you can embed the whole application, but then the user experience will be a challenge. Because in most cases, you will have limited space for the application. So yeah, again, for this kind of integration, toolkit will be the answer, because you will be able to pick which part of the UI you want to use.
Is
that
a presentation?
Yeah, so we're going to go to SCAPI as the next part, and then we'll finish with toolkit.
Okay.
About SCAPI and service client API. What is the purpose of service client API? In fact, it's allowed to have exchanges between the workspace and the website embedded, and the opposite. The website also can do some stuff in workspace, like make call, create an email, update an attached data, start recording, stop recording, trigger a pop-up, and so on. What is the interest of why do we need to use service client API? Because from browsers there is a constraint: a website embedded to another application cannot discuss with it directly if they are not on the same domain. Else, it will generate a cause issue and the operation is refused. But in HTML5, they introduced the notion of post message, allowing to discuss with your parent or with an iFriend. You send just a message, it's a JSON object that you transmit to this target. And if this target accepts it, can read it and do some stuff. And we put in place a protocol and abstract it with a JavaScript file and define an API to expose some stuff around WorkSpace. And with the integration with Service Integrate is really easy. You have just to include a JavaScript and, for example, to do a make call, and with just a single line of JavaScript, you can generate a make call in WorkSpace when you are embedded in it. Yeah. And this is and on the screenshot you see that this is a website embedding, technical website embedding WorkSpace. You're discussing with this technology that with those dot post message provided by HTML. In terms of, and this one I mentioned just before, that there are security constraints. And first, your website must be authorized to use CAPI, and it has to be referenced on the disruption service not API accepted web content origins. Disruption should be set at cluster level, maybe at agent or agent group level. There is a constraint for this one. And if you specify just a website, then you authorize everything. But if you put in parentheses a set of features, like agent.etoile, everything around agent are authorized, interaction, but for example, system operation won't be available. You can adjust with your website what you would like to expose to secure anything. You can also define a rate limit of operation, for example, one make call per minute or 10 updates of data per minute, else the operation will be refused. But this way, it allows to secure also the resources to avoid someone using WorkSpace as a gateway with another system. And this way, we can secure at global or per service. Like I mentioned, for example, I limit to 4 make calls per minute, 2 create emails per minute, and no limit for other. That's an example of control, and this is the first part, security. Second part is about the access to attached data. You have the control of attached data that are exposed to the website, and also that the list of attached data that this website could update. You can potentially can read, but potentially not read, update the attached data. This allows to put some flexibility. And now we are looking to expose options also. With this option, you can specify which option from WorkSpace or custom section that could be exposed in service not API. For example, the website can read the auto answer option for the voice channel if you want to do something particular. And those options also are only at cluster level. Everything around security are at cluster level. Then the API, there are two types of exchanges. First is a request. For example, a request is the demand to do a make call or event. And then not mentioning that there is an incoming call, an in state, release state, and so on. The API is divided in set of namespaces. And you have agent to have information about the agent, the username, and so on. The list of state and the current state that the agent is. You have this notion of global state with completely ready, partial ready, and so on. The API is providing this. Email is just one entry at this time, allowing to create an email from the interface and specifying the email address to use. Of course, it's an email address created in WorkSpace, not in the Outlook or when you create an email in the WorkSpace context. Media to manage each media,
to switch gradient already, the voice channel, the channel and so on. Interaction, then everything about attached data, possibility to select a case. And this is a graphical operation. You can force an interaction to be presented. You can apply a markdown from the science API. You can block the markdown. You can unblock the markdown that you previously blocked. And you have some control. It could be interesting with a script, agent scripting, for example, because if you have a custom agent scripting, then by the way, you can block until the agent is filling all needed information before to close the case. Configuration is new. This one allows to get options. System, there are different kind of. The first one is mentioning all services that are authorized depending of your provisioning. The second is super interesting. It's we have a feature named inactivate timeout. I forgot to put it in security. If the agent is not doing anything in Workspace during a period, it's possible to close automatically the session in terms of security. The issue is if your focus is in an iframe, we don't have, it's not like desktop edition, we don't have how we manage the native timeout. In fact, we listen about event in the page, web page. If you are outside the page, we are not aware. And we are considering there is no activity. Then if the agent is working in an iframe embedded in Workspace or in a pop-up during a long period, in this case, we are not aware about this activity. And the risk is that the Workspace session is stopped in, due to this situation. And to avoid this, we introduce the possibility to alert Workspace that there is still an activity in the embedded website. This is the trigger activity. The latter third function allowing to manage a custom toast in Workspace to alert voice. About voice, a lot of features allowing to answer the app, managing recording, all steps of recording, play with the microphone also when you have an integration with the software, with the speaker also. Yeah. Okay. And for this demo, then I use a similar site.
Stefan?
Yeah.
We have only 15 minutes left.
Yeah.
So maybe we can switch to our toolkit. And this will be visible tomorrow during the afternoon.
Yeah. Okay.
So we're going to skip the Scapy demo. Tomorrow you will have the opportunity to play with Scapy actually. And do you want our integration through provisioning? So in sake of time, and I know that some people are interested by the toolkit, we're going to use the last 15 minutes for our toolkit.
Interesting. Okay, should we see the JavaScript API in the preview, right?
Yeah. And the toolkit, in fact, the toolkit, what it is, in reality, it's an intersection of Workspace in the website, but you expose just a sub part of sub elements from Workspace. For example, you can integrate the interaction bar, the interaction container. You use different components for Workspace and put them at different places of the application. You can for example inject the performance tracker, my channel, team communicator, and so on. Then, in fact, to integrate what we are offering, in fact, it's a subset of Workspace, of elements from Workspace, and we are offering the authentication aspect because. You have to be authenticated to play with this functionality from Workspace. You have also information about the agent to play with the state, to have information about options. You have also the access to chain of command because, like desktop edition, Workspace is based on chain of command. And on any operation that is going to the server, there is a chain of command, a set of command that you will be able to adjust to replace, to add something before, after. It's really, really flexible. This is inherited from the start edition. Yeah. You have interaction manager to be aware about all around interaction, incoming call, changing your state of interaction, and so on. And this part of the toolkit is mostly, what I mentioned, is mostly the notion of model. And this allows to have track the GDLS stack. You don't have to pay attention about Comedy, about the REST API, and so on. This JavaScript code allows to extract this. And after, we have also the notion of views, and there is an entry-point view manager to manage them. And the view that we are offering are the logging view for the second step of logging, to manage when you enter the place, if you are in free sitting, the interaction bar view, agent state view, the global state, communicator, existing communicator, possibility to instantiate or not a toast for interaction, if you like to have your own, but you don't instantiate the toaster view, my channel view, context center statistic and performance tracker view about reporting. And this is different kind of functionality that we are looking to offer in first step opening this summer. Then the toolkit is really based on Workspace, and it's allowing you to integrate some functionality directly from Workspace in your web application. And you inherit everything, and you save a lot of time of development. For example, an interaction bar or a component lighting commutator is super costly. There are a lot of logical and you inherit all this. You inherit from the toolkit, and you, for example, when you make a call, then from the toolkit you inherit from the dial plan that we'll support soon. You also the notion of caller ID and so on, a lot of functionality in background. With the toolkit you inherit of the soft phone integration with the flow that I shown before during the architecture session, and the screen recording is the same. The toolkit, as it is based on Workspace, is relying on options and privileges. If you configure auto answer or not on your agent, and when you are using the toolkit, this notion is applied automatically.
Privileges. If an agent has some read-write view on the TNs, moving points, or it's adapted it in a team communicator? Because in 8.5 it doesn't.
No.
In 9, say the same thing.
It's the same thing.
Privileges. Privileges is really about the ability to do particular action. Like in the player. So it's information.
Do you have plans for it?
It's a very complex topic, permissions. It's very, very complex to manage.
Because we have different kind of business and we don't want some agent to...
Yeah, so we added a couple of helpers in the product on Teamcom. We have options to include, exclude agents in groups, limit visibility to separate line of business. So we did a bunch of addition to the project, to the product to help with that.
Because the agent was supposed to meeting point as well.
Include. I don't remember if it applies to us.
No, not for the moment, but yeah. We have some idea how to have it.
But playing with coffee server permissions is really complex.
And also, you need transparency of feature from Workspace. For example, if you integrate the interaction bar and you set the website integration, and this website will appear in the interaction. And auth also. And if you configure the system to be XAML with the provider, automatically you will be in this mode with the toolkit. Then for the authentication, then there are three modes depending of if iframe is supported or not, then we can use the iframe, else you need to use the pop-up. We have also a mod named embedded, this one, so that's a good idea to use it. This one is during the authentication part, your web page is replaced by the old page and come back to the website after, like WordPress and lot of top web page will support well this mode. It's changing of your engine is slow. Then based on O2 and SSO and SAML are transparent for you. For the toolkit, I mentioned a set of components that you can use, but also you can use the toolkit to do a sync with your CRM. For example, in this example, there is a way to select an interaction if you select something in your CRM. Okay. In terms of line of code, how to inject the toolkit, then first, there is the first line where you have to reference JavaScript from Workspace, API.js. The UI is it's an instance of Workspace. And you have a callback to mention when the toolkit is loaded and ready to be used. This callback is named in this case on Genesis API ready. And on this case, in the sample, for example, we start a loading in pop-up mode. And when it is successful, then we just trust a loading success. In case of pop-up issue, then there is a warning message mentioning that the website cannot be granted to authorize the authentication part. In few line of code, then the toolkit is instantiated. After, for example, to instantiate the view, we will see this later. It's just a single line of code to add the team communicator in a particular in really, really easy to do. Then let's go for the demo. Then I will use again the simulator and in parallel an HTTP server to store in a separate server the toolkit samples and SCAPI samples. Okay. Then my simulator is still running. Okay. Just refresh. I have no session, and I will use a particular page. And this one is a... I'm jumping to the login page from Oath in a pop-up. And then back to the initial custom page. Then from this page, we added a set of components. And we have the global state component. We have, if I configure the notion of resetting with the place to enter at the login, then this will appear in this server. I have my channel. Team communicator. Team communicator in objective. An interaction bar, I can simulate. I can simulate an inbound code. The toast appear. For the moment, the constraint is the toast, it will appear always at the bottom right corner. You don't have a way to decide where it will be. And then you have the interaction bar presented here. And the relative detail of the interaction separated. So you can decide to to let them closer like this in more space, but it's possible to have them separated.
So for a chat, is that actually the session window, the messaging window?
Yeah, in this area, yes. But with the toolkit, you could not have several interaction displays at the same time. This is the same pattern than the workspace. You have the interaction bar where you can have just a single interaction selected at a time.
Yeah, one.
You won't be able to have two chats, for example, in parallel.
Yeah, just one chat session. Yeah. That's fine.
Yeah.
Did I miss? Is there a way to see your work bins too with work?
For the moment, no.
No, we work bin yet.
We could look about this in the future, but for the moment, we focus on voice.
Okay.
Voice only, and
okay.
We try to deliver as soon as it is possible.
All right.
Yeah. And you can see that when I switch to. When I switch off the interaction, you see that the interaction here is changing, the container is changing right into the selected interaction. And you have the performance tracker and context center statistics. And this is the basic example for the. Also, in this example, if I release a call and I try to press markdown, then I need to double check this. I need to check this checkbox to authorize the markdown. There is in fact, we introduce a custom command in the markdown shell to block it. And this is a basic sample. We have another interesting sample is the Genesis Airlines. It's a fake website to Airlines company. And I'm using again John Smith. You can see that. Yeah. Then in this website, what we did is we put the global state in this area. And the agent has a quick access to this. We have the performance tracker appearing in overlay. The possibility to drag it in another place if needed. Team communicator. You have team communicator, and you can hide it if you keep in the background. And if you receive an inbound call, you see that the toast appearing at the corner, at this corner again. And the attraction is also appearing in a relay. You can drag it to another place. Can click on the website, click back to the interaction to see the detail back in front.
Can we keep it visible on time?
Sorry?
Can we keep it visible at all time and still be able to click on the website? Mm-hmm.
You would like to keep always In fact, the shadow in the background is from the custom code, and it was the decision to have this behavior. But you can keep it at the screen if it's just it's just the custom code that we decided to this behavior. It's for you to decide what to do. And you can see also that what is particular is the interaction bar. Is at the top and pushing back the website. When I will release the call and apply the margin, you see that the pop-up, the container is disappearing and the website also is pushing. And this has been done in a few lines of code. There are about drag and drop, there is a third party use. But if we look briefly about the code. Oh, sorry. system logo, some colors. Yeah. About the toolkit, then this is the first page where you have all components. At the top, you have all CSS to manage sizes of containers. There is a particular name for each CSS entry. And this is a lot of stuff, just from how to position the intents. After, like I mentioned, to inject the toolkit in WordPress, then you have to use a script tag with an URL to api.js from WordPress itself, in the instance of WordPress, and with the callback Genesis ready. Some stuff around content about the mode of authentication that we would like to use, pop-up or iframe. And when WordPress is ready, call auth.login with a particular mode. And on success, there is some stuff related to the second view for the login to request the place if configured or not. I think the most of lines of code are related to the login, but quickly you will see that, for example, to add the agent state is really basic. You use the WWE object with the view manager namespace and the method add view dynamic link, and you specify at first the DOM object where the component will be injected, and just after the view that should be injected, the agent state view. Okay. And there is another argument is if the menu is aligned to the left, positioned as WordPress in the right side, or aligned to the right, if it is positioned to the left side. For my channel, it's the same, just add dynamically a view in a particular entry in the DOM, and specify that it's my channel view. What is really interesting is the interaction bar. Interaction bar, then we saw two items, the interaction bar and the container. There is no container component, it's the same. Then how it works, then you add dynamically in a particular element from the DOM an interaction bar view, and in options, you specify a CSS name where the detail of the interaction will be injected. And the rest is and that's it for this sample. And it's done really, really quickly.
And I think we reached the end of this presentation. Any questions?
Okay, approach is that we can show two chat at the same time.
Yeah.
And is it the same with Workspace?
Yes, exactly the same. The whole philosophy behind the toolkit is to reuse as much as we can from Workspace. So you will get the same behavior.
So we cannot have a call and a chat at the same time. Is that?
You can have only one active interaction.
Okay. You have to stack the interaction bar?
Yeah, they're going to stack in the interaction bar, but there will be in there.
Always have to chat.
In the interaction view, you will see only one.
So you could stack them or hide them.
Sorry?
You could stack them or hide them if it's small.
Yeah. Okay. And you choose it.
Yeah.
Same with what you built in the toolkit, right?
So,
It's the same as if you build something with
yes,
the toolkit,
you
can stack them as well.
Yeah, you will get the exact same behavior. So thank you very much for your sustained attention.
Thank you.
During a long session. So the fun begins tomorrow with the end. We're going to play with it. See you tomorrow.
Thank you. Okay.